Please be seated. We're here on this day to certainly honor our memories of Shirley Felton. But also this is a time of worship where we honor, and praise, and thank the Lord our God, her God, for her life and what she meant to each one of us. So as we listen to the prelude, let's prepare our hearts for worship. We will be reading more scripture passages, more extensive scripture passages later on in the service. But as we begin and we think about the meaning of the service, I just wanted to share with you a few, just three real brief scripture passages. One is from Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Jesus said, "Come to me, all ye that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." And then from Psalm 46, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear." Then also from from the book of Psalms, Psalm 103, and also a passage from Isaiah 66. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear God. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. And that is what we seek in this time of worship. So the Lord be with you. And now let's pray together. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask, and you know our ignorance in asking. Show us now your grace, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are ended, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in Jesus, the Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Even in our grief, God wants us to come to Him for comfort and strength and as a refuge. Seeking this comfort, let us confess together to God in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, you see us as we are and know our inmost thoughts. We confess that we are unworthy of your gracious care. We forget that all life comes from you, and that to you all life returns. We have not always sought or done your will. We have not lived as your grateful children, nor loved as Christ loved us. Apart from you, we are nothing. Only your grace can sustain us, Lord. In your mercy, forgive us, heal us, and make us whole. Set us free from our sin, and restore to us the joy of your salvation, now and forever. Amen. God has promised, as we read in Scripture, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all kinds of unrighteousness. Therefore, know that since we have confessed our sin, God has forgiven us, and we have peace with our God. Amen. And now let's pray together again. Loving God, as we read your word, help us to hear what you have for us to hear, and bring comfort to us, and strengthen our hurting hearts. Amen. And now let's read responsively Psalm number 62. Psalm 62. For God alone my soul awaits in silence. From him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock, my salvation, my fortress. I shall never be shaken. How long will you assail a person? Will you batter your victim, all of you, as you would a leaning wall, a tottering fence? Their only plan is to bring down a person of prominence. They take pleasure in falsehood. They bless with their mouths, but inwardly they curse. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from him. He alone is my rock, my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rest my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. And the balances they go up, they are together lighter than a breath. Put no confidence in extortion and set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. Once God has spoken, twice I have heard this. That power belongs to God, and steadfast love belongs to you, O Lord, for you repay to all according to their work. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to
shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness, your shield. raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. Terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and they will raise you up on eagle's wings. Upon their arms they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun.
Gene, I want to share with you how sorry I am at your loss. And to my brothers and my sisters and all of our children, we share that same loss. And to all of you that came today, I want to thank you for coming. Mom must have touched your heart so you wouldn't be here. So on behalf of my family, thank you very much. My name is Steve Wilkes, and I'm Shirley's oldest son. I'm her firstborn child. She told me that a lot. Mom had a great story that got better every year. I was born on a perfect night in Colorado Springs, and it started out to just to be a snowy night. But as the years went on, it became a crystalline snowy night. And then it became a crystalline snowy night with angels and fairies and little snow nymphs. So I'm sorry that I won't get to hear how it would have gotten as time went on, but it did well, and I've played well over the years. Mom was a character. My wife likes to say she was a force of nature, and she was indeed that if you knew her. She was strong-willed. She knew she knew her mind. She always did. And I think that goes back to her beginnings. She was born in 1935. She was born in Canaan, Missouri. It's a little crossroads in the north end of the Ozarks, way up there. We're kind of in the southern end of the Ozarks, but she was born in the Ozarks too, and she never left the farm. In fact, she was very fond of saying, and we've all heard this, those of us who grew up with her, that on the farm, she ended a lot of sentences with on the farm, if you listen to her talk closely. So when we were on the farm, we did it, we cooked this way, we cleaned the house this way. When I was on the farm, this is how we did it. And Mom kept those values with her all her life. The values of working hard and of not running away from your problems, Because when you're on the farm, you can't run away from your problems. You have to deal with them. You have to hit them head on. It's the only way you can live on the farm. And Mom kept that with her whole life. And she taught us kids that. Because she never left the farm. And in some ways, that's how we grew up on the farm, a little bit. Grew up with her cooking. I'll never forget when I came home from the service, maybe the first or second time on leave, I had the best meal I think I ever had in my life. I had green beans and new potatoes and sausage and ham all cooked up. The best peach pie I ever had in my life, ever. Never have a meal that good again. But when we were growing up, Mom found herself a single mother. My dad left us in 1967. He had a car wreck. And Mom had five little kids that she had to take care of. And I don't know how she found the strength to do it. But she did. And every night we'd come home and we'd have pinto beans on Tuesday night and pork chops on one night and something called chicken Jenny Rose on another night. And when we got a little bit older, there was something called liver surprise. And I will not even talk to you about that in a house of God. I will not. But Mom kept trying and she kept working at it and she taught us, again, it was our job to get dinner on. It was our job to do that. She taught us how to work a little bit at a time and how to be responsible for ourselves, how to pick up after ourselves, how to clean the bathroom, how to work in the yard. I'll never forget my brother Mike getting over on me once when he was about 8 or 9 because we were out there and it was supposed to be my job to rake half the yard and his job to break the other half of the yard. But he had it over on me because he could pretend that he was too little to do it. And he had mom fooled on that. And another thing about my mother that I never really knew until this had to have been in the early 80s, but I never knew how fast she could move. She could move with the grace of a ballerina and the speed of a linebacker. And I knew that when I think it was Tommy and John. I can't remember exactly who it was, but a couple of my brothers threw a couple of firecrackers under her hind end when she was gardening. And both my brothers and my mom moved with more speed than I've ever seen humans in my life. She caught them. And it's a good memory. I didn't throw the firecrackers. I'm going to miss my mom. She led a wonderful, she led quite a life. She was, like I say, she never really left the farm. But on the other hand, when she took us back to Missouri from Colorado, she wanted to be close to her family, to the Deckers, to her maternal family. And but she didn't want to be too close because she wanted to raise us. She didn't want to be raised in Owensville. She wanted to raise us in Kansas City, and that's what she did. And then she met our stepfather, whose name was Tom Burchett, and he's been dead now for quite a long time. And they were married a long time. And she had quite an interesting life with him. And she lived overseas. They lived in Saudi Arabia. Mom would go grocery shopping in Rome because, of course, women can't go out by themselves in Arabia, and that used to just make Mom so angry. But she found a way around that, and then she would travel the whole world, and she loved that. And then eventually she and Jean met and fell in love, and they'd been married for 20 years. And what a marvelous life they've led, and what a marvelous man Jean is and his family. And we're so blessed to have them in our lives. Can't tell you. I can't tell you how much you meant to my mom. Thank you. So, from my heart to yours, on behalf of my mother, don't leave the farm. Keep those values. Love each other. Remember my mom. Thank you very much.
experiencing. Learned a lot about Shirley over the last 20 years.
Ooh, a little closer.
All right, thank you. And one of the things that I learned about her is that when she had an important message to send, she would sometimes choose to do that by collecting her thoughts and putting them into a letter. And that might be why, as I gathered my own thoughts today, I found that they sort of fell into the shape of a letter to Shirley. And so I'd like to share that with you. This also, because it's a letter, it gives me the excuse of reading rather than speaking extemporaneously. So here we go. Dear Shirley, I wanted to catch you with some updates and thoughts on this important day. You'll be happy to know that your deck garden is in full bloom and just gorgeous with the lake sparkling behind it. My dad has the bird feeder out, and the cardinals are as busy as ever. There's one persistent squirrel back there who thinks it has the run of the place since that old cat moved on. I wish you were here to see the flowers, though. Like you, they're turning their faces to the sun, vibrant and bold. Surely there's been a real outpouring of support over the last few weeks and continuing today. They just keep coming. The calls and cards, the visits from friends, meal drop-offs, and offers of support. We're all so grateful for that, especially Jean. We see how the love that you fostered throughout your life, among your family and friends in your church and in your community, continues to flow now, bringing comfort and healing and even optimism amidst loss. You had great optimism, Shirley, rooted in belief. You are a person who believed in things. I'm not just talking about your belief in the Hogs or Patrick Mahomes. Although you could be right that if it weren't for that bad toe, Super Bowl 55 might have turned out very differently. You believed in all of us. You saw our potential. And you urged us forward to be the best version of ourselves that we could be. I'm not saying that was always easy. I'm not sure that you were about easy. But I'm not sure that that's all bad. You believed in family. You were fiercely loyal and deeply dedicated to your children, each of them individually, but also as siblings, traveling life's journey together. Your eyes never shined as brightly as they did when you spoke about Mike and Tommy and Karen and John and Steve. And from the day that you came into our lives, those eyes looked with love and acceptance on your 9 Felton stepsons. You believed that the care and support shared within a family is one of life's greatest gifts, a gift that, following your example, we have the privilege to continue to nurture and sustain. You believed in this place, this congregation, and in faith and prayer and forgiveness and reconciliation. You believed in gratitude, which you expressed freely and with eloquence. It's fitting that the last words that I heard from you a few weeks ago, softly but clearly, even through your pain and exhaustion. We're thank you. Now, Shirley, it's our turn to say thank you. Thank you for the love and companionship and support and laughter that you shared so abundantly with Jean over the past 2 decades. Thank you for sharing with us your amazing family. And for welcoming all the Feltons with our quirks and flaws and receding hairlines into your remarkable life. Thank you for your generous service, given with passion and conviction to your church and your community. I can think of no greater accolade when looking back on a person's life than to say that they have left us better than they found us. Thank you, Shirley, for doing exactly that. With deepest affection, Brian.
Thank you, Brian, and Steve, and Dan. What wonderful testimonies. And now, let's read another love letter. 1 Peter, chapter 1, we'll be reading verses 3 through 9. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now, for a little while, you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, we each have our memories of Shirley. Those of us who are fellow church members and friends, those of you of the family. And my, what a large family. But that's good. That is good. And thank you for the memories that you have shared. Now, I want to share just a few of mine. I met Shirley right over here in that parlor where we met before coming out. We had a stewardship and finance committee meeting. I had just joined the church, and the chairman of the committee said, Ronnie, would you, given your experience and so on, would you be interested in joining the stewardship and finance committee? I said, well, I'd be glad to help however I can. I wish I had known. Jim, it wasn't the most fun I've ever had, okay? But it was good, and it's an important work. I hope all of you involved in churches appreciate and support the work of your stewardship finance committee. Well, anyway, after the committee, Shirley came out, always smiling, right? Always smiling. She had to have different moods, but always had the same smile. Were you able to interpret the mood no matter the smile? Okay. Well, we went out and we got to talking, and we ended up sitting down in my car and just talking about the committee, about the budget work, and all the accounting of the church, and so on. And she showed me a little bit of the background. She didn't tell me all of it. I began to recognize she was a complex, multidimensional person, wasn't she? There's a lot to her. I knew that she was an accountant. I knew that she was a numbers person. She soon let me know she had her way of doing things. And couldn't understand why other people wouldn't do it the same way. And by the way, a lot of the time, when I recall, she was right. And don't tell her I said, there might have been times when she was wrong, but she would still be smiling. But she was not only an accountant, but a numbers person, and all that that means, the reality of numbers. She was an adventurer. We talked about going on cruises. I remember, didn't you go on a Queen Mary cruise? The second Queen Mary, I'm assuming, right? Around South America. Wow. Actually, she stopped being a polywog. Did y'all have a ceremony with that when you cross the equator like you're supposed to, where King Neptune declares those that have now crossed, you're now hardbacks, or what, isn't that the term, Navy people, and not a polywog anymore? But an adventurer. She wasn't just hard on the numbers, she was willing to take risks. She was a proud woman, in the best sense of the term. She was proud of you. Boy. In fact, Steve, I think I told you this when I shopped in your store a couple years ago. She asked me, Ron, what are your hobbies? Do you play golf? I said, no, ma'am. And she said, well, you won't fit in. No, she didn't say I wouldn't fit in at Belle Vista. She said, well, what do you do? And I mentioned the scuba diving. I said, I'm going to get into beer brewing. Well, you need to meet my son, Steve. And so I did. I realized that with all of these things, she was very self-assured, knowing ways to do things and wanting other people to do it the same way, all of that. But despite, and I didn't realize all of the trials and tragedies, difficulties she had had to endure. And I'm not talking about our children. But despite the difficulties and the hardships, there was always that smile. And she was always a rock for her family. But she also knew that she needed God. That God, as we read, was her ultimate refuge, her ultimate rock. But despite being that rock and being a rock for the family, she knew she needed the rock, and you were a rock for her, all of you. But despite all that hardship and difficulty that could make somebody stronger, hard, she remained soft. She remained gentle. She wasn't cold, but warm and loving. And again, and smiling. I know I've said it before, and I'm going to say it again. Always smiling. Gene, I loved it whenever you would sing a solo in church. You know, I loved the way she looked at you. You know, that was special. So there's so much from each of you that we all can learn about Shirley. But also, I think from our two scripture passages, I'd like to just share with you just a couple of brief things I think we learn about Shirley and why she was the way she was. First of all, in Psalm 62 and verse 12, again, that she relied on God's steadfast love, a love that cannot be shaken, and it flowed through her to you and to all of us. Because her love for her friends, for her church, for her family was steadfast. But also in the passage we read, 1 Peter there in chapter 1, she was tested by fire. And she was proven gold. And she gave the glory to God. Because in my encounter with her, it was never about her. It was about God and how good God was. Family, you have gone through the fire. You're going through the fire of grief. And you will go through the fire of grief. But as you grieve, and by the way, we're not told as Christians to avoid grief. That Paul wrote, we grieve, but not as those who have no hope. That's a key to remember. So as you grieve, be thankful for Shirley, and I know you will. Be thankful for her steadfast love. Laugh some. Cry some. I think that's part of what the psalmist meant when he said, pour your hearts out. Do that. It's good. It's part of the way God heals us, I think. That's just part of that healing process. And when we grieve the loss of a loved one, it's a lifelong process. But as you walk through that fire, as God walks through you, as you remember, as you laugh, as you cry, those memories, God, through those memories, will refine you and make you gold and produce golden memories until we are all united in eternity. Amen. And now let's pray together. Oh God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants, who having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant, Shirley, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of her life, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful and strong, and for the grace that you gave her, for the grace that kindled in her the love for your name and enabled her to serve you faithfully. We thank you, Lord, that for you, she was a dear servant, she was a child, and she was precious. But we thank you that for her, death is past, and life and pain, the pain is ended, and that she has now entered into the joy you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, Lord, give us faith to see beyond touch and sight some sure sign of your kingdom, and where and when our vision fails, help us to trust your love, which never fails. Lift our heavy sorrow and give us good hope in Jesus, so that we may bravely walk our earthly way and look forward to glad reunion in the life to come through Jesus the Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debts. Is not in temptation, but delivers from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Again, the Felton family, thanks you for honoring Shirley's memory by your presence today. And they invite you to a reception after the benediction in the fellowship hall. After the benediction, I will lead them out and proceed with them down to the fellowship hall, and then you will be ushered out. Let us pray. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Shirley Felton. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus the Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you, all of us, always. Amen.